period is over, and we'll begin our panel discussion on public funding of research. I think most of the so I'm Tom Parks. Most of the published literature on how we need to fix the problems with replicability emphasize that there will be a role for faculty and their institutions, for funding agencies, and for the journals. And we've heard a little bit about that, and we'll hear more about journals. Probably won't hear as much about faculty as we should, because there really aren't that many organized efforts to help faculty deal with this problem. But the funding agencies have been aware of this for a number of years, and it's hard to imagine, even in a political culture that doesn't do a very good job of keeping its eye on the ball and consistently pursuing effectiveness, at some point it seems that people who pay the public, who pay for most of the research that's done, will want to know that the results are actually reliable. There was a study, Friedman and colleagues published a study, and a very interesting paper in PLOS 1 last year, doing an analysis of a review of published literature on replicability in preclinical studies. And they came to the conclusion, which to me seems reasonably well supported, that about $28 billion a year of funded preclinical research is wasted because the results don't meet reasonable standards of replicability. You could argue maybe, and most of that is federal funding. So some of it is drug company funding, but most preclinical research is funded by the government, and most of it is funded by the National Institutes of Health. So I've always thought that at some point, the people acting through their government will want to know what we've all been doing with that money, and we'll find out that we haven't maybe been giving them the best value for the dollar, and then they'll come ask us to do something about it. So that was really what generated my interest in doing something at the institutional level about improving the reliability of research. So we're fortunate today to have two speakers from the federal government with two different perspectives on the problems of replicability, and we'll have that both of them will make presentations, and then we'll have a panel discussion and hope to have lots of questions about this. So there's more details on their biographies in the program. I'll just briefly introduce Dr. Lisa Meier McShane, our first speaker, who's a mathematical statistician and chief of the Biostatistics branch at the National Cancer Institute. She's also on the Scientific Advisory Board for Science Translational Medicine and the Editorial Board for BMC Medicine. And then following her will be Dr. Kathy Partin, who's director of the Office of Research Integrity for the Department of Health and Human Services. Prior to assuming this position, Dr. Partin was a professor of biomedical sciences and Associate VP for Research at Colorado State University. So it's a pleasure to welcome Dr. McShane. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here and an honor to be here, and I hope that I will give you some more food for thought to continue the excellent discussion that we got started this morning. Okay, here we are. All right, I do make note of my disclosure at the bottom. That's the price of being a Fed. I think it's always helpful to hear something about the background of the speaker and what perspective they might have on the issue at hand. So I am a statistician, and a large part of my job is reviewing protocols. I also have time that I can devote to research in collaborative studies as well as doing statistical methodologic research. I work with two journals on editorial boards or advisory boards. And I'm also involved in efforts to develop reporting guidelines, and you will hear from the expert later on today, David Moher. And maybe a reason that I sort of have gotten into this area of reproducible research is that I found myself thrown into a research misconduct scandal that occurred at Duke University, some of you may have heard of. I was working on the NCIN to help sort of untangle what happened, and I learned a whole lot, and I hope I can give you some perspectives on the kinds of environment that can lead to not only research irreproducibility, but also scientific misconduct. But you will hear more from Kathy Partin about the specific issue of misconduct. So this has gotten the attention of even the U.S. Senate. Dr. Francis Collins, the head of the NIH, had to testify in front of a committee to answer the questions that Senator Shelby had with regard to why he's hearing so much publicity about irreproducible science. And there have been some key papers that have been published showing the problems of irreproducibility in particularly preclinical research. And I should explain that my particular domain of specialty is biomarker studies. So I'm used to kind of bridging that gap between laboratory work and clinical work. And it gives me sort of a nice perspective on both ends of the spectrum. So one of the things that caused a stir in the field of oncology was a paper that you already heard mentioned this morning, written by Begley and Ellis. They had reported on some investigations they had done at the biotech firm Amgen, where they had tried to reproduce the results in 53 studies describing preclinical work, and had a rather dismal success rate of only being able to reproduce the results in 6 out of those 53 studies, or a success rate of 11%. And this really caused a lot of concern in the field, and rightfully so. There was another effort actually earlier, and these are just examples, I'm sure there are other papers, in the field of neurology, looking at the disease ALS, also called Lou Gehrig's disease, you may be familiar with it. These researchers had gone through about 50 publications, and again, had tried to reproduce the results. And they basically came up with the conclusion that they observed no statistically significant positive or negative effects for all of the 70 different compounds that they had tried to reevaluate. And they concluded that the published effects were most likely measurement of noise. And in fact, it appeared that gender effects may have had a lot to do with this noise, that they were sort of mistaken as drug effects. This has some real consequences when you're in the field of public health or biomedical research. You know, at the end of the line is the patient. And so we're doing a disservice to patients if we can't do reproducible work that leads to better things for patients. And the ALS example is one example of that. There was a big study that had been done in ALS looking at the drug minocycline. And after all these promising papers had been published showing preclinical results, they actually launched a big study. And in fact, the study came up with negative results. So the patients who were on the experimental therapy actually, it appeared, were harmed by the treatment. So this is not only a bad result in that we couldn't reproduce, but in fact that it looked like patients had actually been harmed because of poor quality science. There have been many stories in oncology about failed, in this particular case, genomic profiles. The first one was actually a proteomic profile for detection of ovarian cancer called OverSure. The second one was the Duke Potty genomic predictors. It's what I mentioned earlier, big research misconduct scandal at Duke University in which the researchers had developed mathematical models that could be used, they claim, to predict which therapy would work better for a given patient by analyzing the genetics of the patient's tumor. So when you hear stories like this, and again, those are only examples, there are many more that I'm sure even those of you in the room could come up with, but we kind of need to take an FFA plane crash approach to this and say, all right, we had these really significant failures, and can we look back and understand why they happened? So I'm going to try and go through an analysis like this. I will use some examples from the Duke misconduct scandal, but I also picked a number of things from the literature. They came to my attention through various routes. And I'm not trying to claim that any of these other examples are examples of research misconduct, but they are examples of sloppy science. So I like to think of this whole issue of reproducibility of science as being kind of an onion. You can think of peeling off the layers of the onion, and you start with the design and primary data generation, you move on to the analysis of those data, and then you have to interpret those results and report them. And then those results get disseminated out to the scientific or biomedical community. Unfortunately, sometimes by the time you're finished peeling that onion, you're in tears. So first example, design considerations. This was a published paper, was actually sent to me by someone as an example of a potentially problematic study design. Does anybody see a problem with that study design? Is anyone worried that maybe the signature is confounded with gender or age? Okay. So you have to ask yourself, why would somebody do a study like that? Okay. I mean, maybe what they developed was real, but why would you take that risk? Another example. This was another signature, this time for ovarian cancer. And this one came to my attention because I'm on the email list for things like Genome Web. And you know, you get the email splash and the headlines, so-and-so developed a wonderful classifier for disease or for outcome on a particular disease. And so often I'll open up those links and I'll take a look and see what claim is being made. And my antenna go up when I see a claim such as, we developed a classifier that is 100% accurate in detecting ovarian cancer. Well, people have been trying to do this for many years, so I'll look through those papers sometimes and see what I think of them. Well, this one actually had a number of problems. I'm citing it here as one example of a design issue. Here, all of the normal samples came from one clinical site. The ovarian cancer samples came from a variety of sites. So you have to rely quite heavily on being able to tease out clinical side effect from the actual ovarian cancer versus normal sample based on just that first site, that NS. That's the only way you can attempt to untangle it because everything else is confounded, site with status of ovarian cancer. Okay, so again, little things, simple questions researchers can ask themselves if they're trying to develop a study plan. This example was actually sent to me by one of our grantees, and he said to me, please disseminate this message. What you're looking at there is called a heat map, and every little pixel, colored pixel in that plot, represents a combination of a gene and a tumor sample. So in this particular picture, there were 215 tumor samples analyzed corresponding to the columns in that pixel diagram, and there were 116 genes. This investigator had spent years accumulating samples in this particular cancer type, running these assays, and in the end was getting grant money to try and validate a predictor that he had developed. When he finally had all of his data accumulated, he did this simple little plot. Unfortunately, midway through the several-year period in which he was doing these experiments, there had been some changes in the reagents used for the gene expression microarrays. And you can see from that plot, it makes a huge difference. Okay? So again, planning. You need to think about how all of these little factors, technical factors, can influence results. This was an example, different study. This one I was actually involved in helping to analyze the data. And as is very common in preclinical work or biomarker studies that are done retrospectively in specimens, people are not having these formal, you know, locked clinical databases. They're handling data on Excel spreadsheets. So I had gotten one installment of the data that you see there on the left, and they were still running samples, and when they finished running the second set of samples, they sent me the second one. Anybody see a problem with that? Now, I'm just kind of an anal statistician who likes to do double checks of data, okay? But things like this happen all the time. And in fact, even in the Duke misconduct scandal, one of the issues was people not able to handle Excel spreadsheets appropriately. And this is an example of what happened in the Duke situation. What you're looking at there, it's a sort of a complicated picture, but basically every little bar that you see there, you see how it changes from blue to red? Well, within a block of columns, it should either be solid blue or solid red, okay? Because what you're looking at is a set of cell lines that are held fixed, and you're also looking at sensitivity measures for that cell line when a particular chemotherapy was applied, okay? So the same data were being used in multiple studies. The data were being posted on journal websites, for example, or on the institution's website. And there were two statisticians at MD Anderson Cancer Center who said, well, let's just take a look at this data, and they started to compare the data. Well, it turned out that even though they were supposed to be the same data, depending on which publication or which website posting you were looking at, the designation of resistant or sensitive to a particular chemotherapy changed. Okay, and I had the unfortunate opportunity to actually look through some of the data files as we were trying to untangle things with the folks at Duke, and it was an absolute horror. There were data files that were not labeled, columns had been scrambled, chunks of rows were missing. These were people who were just messing around with data files, didn't know what they were doing. And the serious aspect of this is these were the basis for genomic predictors that were used in clinical trials to direct therapy for patients. So this is more than an academic issue. Okay, this is not just data sloppiness. There were real implications. So the bottom line message is that if you're not careful with how you set up your study design, and if you're not careful with your data handling, things are all over at that point, okay? Because you have data that's totally corrupted or unusable, and you don't even need to analyze it from that point forward. The concerning thing is that those who are doing the analysis may not be the same people who are doing the data handling. And so you don't know, if you're the person receiving the data to analyze, whether you can trust the data or not. So we need to have some better training of scientists and statisticians in basic study design principles. And these people have to be more involved in the design of these research projects. Reviewers of protocols, study plans, grant proposals, or published manuscripts need to ask these simple questions. Was there important confounding of a clinical characteristic and some experimental, some endpoint that you were interested in, for example? And we also need careful description of these characteristics. I've picked up many a paper where I see a comparison of marker values between those who had cancer and those who didn't. And one of the first things I do is I look for a table that describes the patient population. What are the characteristics? Because many times you will find there's some serious confounding. We also need better education or even requirements for data management practices, and we need to be able to document data provenance. We also need to specifically designate people who are going to be in charge of the data. This is not a job for Joe the postdoc in the lab who's handy with Excel spreadsheets. You know, if you're dealing with something that is going to lead to an intervention for a patient, you need to be more careful than that. Data analysis. It's wonderful that we have so much freely available statistical software. We have to make sure the people using that software know what they're doing. This was an example I pulled out of one of the Duke papers that was eventually retracted. Okay, I don't know how many of you in the room are statisticians or have ever done something called a log rank test. Okay, that's an analysis you do on survival data. So the legend of that figure, which really is should have been describing a regression analysis, says a log-rank test was done. This got through journal reviewers, got through the co-authors in the paper. How did that happen? We also have a big problem, of course, that when people do a lot of data analysis, they can come up with spurious findings. And some of you may have learned in a basic statistics course that if you do 20 tests, you should be dividing your alpha by 20, and that's a way to account for the increase in false positives that you might experience if you're doing a lot of data analysis. But people often don't realize there are many forms of multiple testing or multiple comparisons, which is the issue we're dealing with here. Not only is it that you're doing multiple tests, but it could be that you're looking at many different endpoints, you're looking at many different models. Could be you're applying cut points to a continuous variable to kind of find that cut point that gives you the best separation of survival curves. So these are all forms of multiple comparisons. So, you know, we can bash p-values, and probably rightfully so in a lot of cases. But if there have been a lot of tests done, p-values become uninterpretable. Another data analysis example, this is going back to the Overshore example, which was the proteomic test for distinguishing between ovarian cancer and not. And this, not long after it was published, generated a lot of letters to the editor. And one was from a group of mostly statisticians, including, in a troubling way, the statistician on the paper, criticizing his own paper. Okay? So they had reported in the paper that their classifier they had developed had 95.3% sensitivity and 99.4% specificity. Now, any of you who have ever read anything on ovarian cancer detection know it's a tough problem, and we have not come up with anything that does even a halfway acceptable job at detecting ovarian cancer. Okay, so this finding, if it were correct, is big. Okay? Unfortunately, there were big problems. Okay? One of the things we find a lot in especially omic studies, which are studies that are looking at sort of large numbers of variables measured on each patient or on each specimen, looking at, say, lots of protein levels or lots of gene expression values within each patient, there are a lot of statistical traps. And if you don't know what you're doing, you can easily come up with spurious findings. And we see it all the time in the literature. I see it in protocols I review when people are providing information about background data supporting a classifier that they want to use. You know, we have to go back and look at the original publications they're citing and figure out if the development and the supposed validation of that classifier was legitimate. In this particular case, this was an example where the investigators had developed this classifier on what they called a training data set, and then they had a set-aside set that was the test set or sort of a validation set. Well, unfortunately, when they presented the final results in the paper, they put the two back together. Okay, so when you do that, of course, you have designed that classifier to work well on the data you trained it on. So if you now plug it in, you know, plug the data from the training set back into that classifier, of course it's going to work. You built it to work. Okay? And even if you merge in a test set, still huge amounts of bias. So the point here is that the ability to run statistical software does not equate with statistical expertise, and we find often there's confusion in study teams about who exactly is the statistician or who has the statistical expertise. And you don't have to have a formal degree in statistics necessarily to have statistical expertise, but it is often unclear who at all in a study team has the appropriate expertise. So some recommendations here. We, of course, need to get the right people on the study team. And I'm frequently distressed when I see papers that have really bad statistical analyses, and then when I see a statistician who's a co-author on the paper. So where was that person? Well, what happens sometimes is the statistician was responsible for preparing the clinical data set that they then handed over to somebody who knew how to run all kinds of software. Okay? So there's that gap in knowledge and expertise to make sure that what is being done is appropriate. Results interpretation is another layer in the onion. this, again, going back to the Overshore example, and I'm not trying to pick on this, but I didn't want to have you going flopping between too many different examples. This one just unfortunately happened to be a rich source of points to make. So the paper reported that the positive predictive value was 99.3% and the negative predictive value was 99.2%. This is phenomenal, okay? So positive predictive value means if you've gotten a positive test result, the chance that you actually have ovarian cancer, in this case, they're claiming with this predictor, 99.3%. And maybe even more important to the many people who are not going to have ovarian cancer when you apply this test, is the negative predictive value. So if the test says you're negative, you can go home, rest assured, you do not have ovarian cancer. Well, unfortunately, there was a misunderstanding here about how these this kind of test would actually be applied. If you're applying it at a population level as a screening test, the prevalence of disease, of ovarian cancer, in that screening population would be quite small. Much smaller, and usually the figure people quote is about 1 in 2,500 women tested in a screening setting will actually have ovarian cancer. Well, unfortunately, when the positive and negative predictive values were studied, were computed by the study authors, they used the prevalence in their study, which was 50%. And one of the things about positive and negative predictive value is they depend very heavily on the population prevalence. So if you plug in the wrong population prevalence to calculate your positive predictive value and negative predictive value, you're going to be wildly off base. And so the authors of this letter to the editor said, well, if we plug in the right value, the positive predictive value is not 99.3%, it's 6.5%, okay? Meaning that only 1 in 15 women with a positive test result will actually have ovarian cancer. Other kinds of interpretation issues. One of the things I always do when I review a paper is I look back, I specifically circle what claims are being made, and I look back in the paper and say, okay, what is the evidence that was presented to support this claim? Okay? And people have these words they throw around to make claims, and one of the most abused words is validation. What did you validate, and how did you validate it? So this was an example, again, of a signature in a very hot area right now in oncology, immunotherapy. And they said that this signature was the basis for clinical response to a particular immunotherapy, which was a CTLA-4 blockade in melanoma. And there was a claim that they have validated their signature in a second set of 39 patients. Well, some people apparently read the article, wrote some letters to the editor, and said, what do you mean validation? Validation, you used the same patients in your validation. And I described earlier this issue of overfitting and, you know, reusing the data. And the response from the authors, as is often the case when authors are confronted with letters to the editor, was rather confusing. They said they did not use validation set in the conventional way. In contrast to a formal biomarker analysis, our study design focused on defining a recurrent genetic footprint that occurred in a non-random fashion. I don't know what that means. Okay. Study reporting, and you're going to hear a lot about this from one of the world's experts later on today. But the only way you can appropriately evaluate a study is if people report the details, because the details can be really important. And so the whole idea of reporting guidelines is to allow people to evaluate the appropriateness and quality of a study, understand the context in which it applies, to facilitate reproducibility, and to allow comparisons across studies, or perhaps do formal meta-analyses. And I'm sure David will be telling you about the Equator website, which catalogs probably hundreds, Davis could tell us the right number, of reporting guidelines for various kinds of health research studies. Dissemination of irreproducible research is also a problem. This goes back to the paper that was done by the folks at Amgen that showed they couldn't reproduce any more than 11% of the preclinical study results. And somewhat more disturbing was that the ones they couldn't reproduce were more likely to be cited and more likely to be cited in higher impact journals. Why is that? Because when we do irreproducible research, we enrich for false positive findings. And the false positive findings are often the really magnificent looking findings, so they get the attention. They get into the good journals, or what people perceive to be the good journals, I should say. Also, there are many people with vested interests, so people want to disseminate their study results. In the Duke example, they made it into the pages of The Economist, international audience, that they had developed predictors that could predict which type of chemotherapy would give the patient the greatest chance of cure. And they mentioned that they were already starting up clinical trials to evaluate these. There was advertising through various routes. There were even TV commercials promoting these. There was a lab that had opened up offering these tests. Unfortunately, there is a loophole in the FDA oversight for diagnostic tests. Believe it or not, many diagnostic tests that you could get at your doctor's office have never seen the eyes of a FDA reviewer. But that's a topic for another day. The problem is, once people get really neat findings, it just spreads like wildfire, and it's hard to pull it back to convince people that this is not a result that you can trust. So some other recommendations specific to the issue of reporting and interpretation. I think reporting guidelines are extremely helpful. In fact, a lot of the people I know who use one of the reporting guidelines that I co-led the development of say that they actually hand it to the postdocs as they walk in the lab the first day and say, read these reporting guidelines and understand them. And I used to think, well, they're confused about what the purpose of reporting guidelines, and that really reporting guidelines are saying, when you're done with your study, tell us how you did it, okay, and tell us what your results were. But in fact, really, we're being kind of sneaky with reporting guidelines. What we're saying is that these are the things we're going to want to hear about when you go to publish your study. So maybe you ought to think about them now before you start your study, because there's a reason we're asking you to report them. They matter. The validity of your study may depend on your answers to those reporting elements. Okay. And importantly, we need to make sure that even the negative findings are disseminated. A well-done study with negative results, and I don't mean that's the same necessarily as insignificant results, with negative results are as important or more to get out there. And we all have heard about publication bias, selective reporting even within a study of certain results that gave the significant p-values or not. This is really a critical issue. And data sharing, of course, can be a really important aspect of this. I was really taken by a letter that was sent by the Vice Chancellor for Clinical Research at Duke to the authors of the manuscripts. There were, I think, 30 or 40 some manuscripts that were published by this group of researchers who developed these chemosensitivity predictors. And we heard from the Duke officials that essentially none of the co-authors had come forward when there were questions being asked about these papers. So the Duke Vice Chancellor, in collaboration with the head of the Institute for Genome Science and Policy at Duke, sent a letter to all the co-authors and said, we need to maintain public trust, and we want to assure that you can identify the person or persons responsible for the data management, statistical analysis, and interpretation of the results. Well, at that point, there was a lot of finger pointing. So who was going to stand up and take credit or responsibility for all the things that went wrong in the study? Everyone was happy to be a co-author, but who was going to take responsibility? So as we're developing study protocols, grant proposals, we need to be more specific about the individuals who are going to be accountable for these different aspects. We have a review process at NCI for use of biospecimens that were collected on our therapy trials. And so people can request those specimens after the study is completed, and they can do biomarker studies. We actually make them now specify exactly who the statistician is, who's going to be doing those analyses. If it involves like omics kind of data where there are a lot of complicated bioinformatics analyses, we want to know who that bioinformatician is. And that person has to have actually bought into the protocol and approved it. I have on more than one occasion had questions about a protocol in a review, and I contact the person whose name is listed as the study statistician. And I would say about 25-33% of the time, their response is, I have never seen the protocol. Okay? Your name is on the protocol. You are responsible, and the other study team members are responsible for making sure that all of the team members have seen that protocol and approved it. And the same with journals. And many journals already do this. You're supposed to list who is responsible for which parts of the paper. I think that should be required by every journal. And it should be a fairly detailed accounting of who did what and who's going to stand by what. So some things that have been underway since last few years where we've had these problems with reproducibility. One was there was an Institute of Medicine study that was commissioned to specifically look at the field of translational omics. This was kind of spurred by the whole Duke scandal. And one of the really scary things about the Duke scandal, I mean, scandals can happen anywhere, was everyone's perception that, you know what, this could happen a lot of places, including my institution, right? Because there are so many gaps in the system. There were also efforts by people at NIH to develop more reporting guidelines. Particularly this one was sort of in reaction to the Begley and Ellis paper and other papers, but the group was actually led by somebody in the Neurology Institute because of their failed ALS trial. So they said, where are we going wrong? What information do we need to know in the earlier stages of the research so we don't go down these wrong paths? Journals have really made some significant effort to try and improve things. Many of them are using checklists. They're asking for more detailed descriptions of experimental designs and allowing for supplementary materials so that those details can have a home. They're encouraging authors to provide more data, particularly data that sits behind tables and figures. They're doing enhanced statistical review. I know Nature, for example, actually pays statisticians to do detailed reviews of selected papers, those that seem to be very reliant on the statistical analyses. NIH has also started up several initiatives to enhance reproducibility, and they're particularly focusing on resources to establish repositories for protocols, data, computer code. They're trying to strengthen journal review, working with journal editors without stifling creativity. It's interesting to me that I often get the comment when I talk about reporting guidelines, and maybe David will elaborate on this. Sometimes the response I get is, I don't want anyone telling me what to do. And my response back to them is, reporting guidelines aren't telling you what to do. They're saying, you tell us what you did. Okay? And that's a really critical distinction. So NIH recently released some revised grant guidelines, and some of the key specifics are that there will be specific focus in four areas. One is the scientific premise forming the basis for the proposed research. As I mentioned, when I review protocols, if there's some key background papers mentioned, I actually go look up the papers and see if the papers are on solid footing. They're looking for more rigorous descriptions of experimental design with statistical power calculations when appropriate. Consideration of relevant biological variables. Have people worried about confounding of important things like gender? Authentication of key biological and chemical resources. Are you sure that that cell line is actually what you think it is? Are you sure that that antibody is actually what you think it is? There's also been an initiative to improve clinical trials, ranging from requiring good clinical practice training. Also, there have been development of some protocol templates that are being used in some study sections. And this is going to be basically all study sections eventually. Also, issues of registering in clinicaltrials.gov, that's going to be required. And the results have to be reported into clinicaltrials.gov. You know, the taxpayers have paid for all this. Patients are counting on us to do research that's valid and that actually advances the field. So to summarize, I think research reproducibility is not just an academic issue. Okay? There are many, many examples where bad research has resulted in potentially harm to patients. If nothing else, wasting the patient's time and wasting the taxpayers' money and diverting resources away from good research. But don't be mistaken, achieving research reproducibility is not an easy thing. It really takes buy-in from a lot of stakeholders, and it takes a culture change. It's going to take effort and resources. Thank you. I'm going to do questions after. Okay.
Good morning. Thank you very much for this invitation. I'm delighted to be here. And I'm not surprised that an effort like this comes from the University of Utah, which has a strong history of innovative and ethical research. So I'm the director of the Department of Health and Human Sciences Office of Research Integrity. And the views I express are my own, and I have no financial conflict of interest in expressing them. One thing that I want to start by saying is that I think we have the strongest machine for performing biomedical research in the world. And it has many successes. And if any of you have taken a loved one to the hospital with a serious disease recently, I think that you understand the power of the biomedical research program that the taxpayers have funded. And I think it's important for us to never undersell the power of publicly sponsored basic and clinical research. That doesn't mean that I am not as angry as you are about when science goes wrong and the impact on patients. So I bet you're wondering, with all of this irreproducibility, what my office is doing to ensure the integrity of research. And I want to remind you that we have two divisions in ORI. One is adjudicating research misconduct, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that today. But the other is promoting research integrity. And this is where I think we could partner with institutions more aggressively and with a higher impact, and I want to talk about that today too. So first of all, it's important to know that in ORI, we look at only one kind of bad acts. That is FFP, data fabrication, falsification, or plagiarism. I think a lot of what we think of when we think about irreproducible results is not actually FFP. It's something different. It is reckless, sloppy, careless, malignant process, but it's not FFP. I think the very best studies suggest that maybe 2% of investigators knowingly or intentionally engage in FFP. In order to be found guilty of research misconduct, you have to have committed FFP. This has to be a significant departure from accepted practices in the relevant community. And I hope you appreciate how subjective those terms are. A significant departure from the accepted practices in a relevant community. And I think we have to ask ourselves, how well do we define and articulate what the accepted practices in a relevant community are? These acts have to have been committed intentionally, knowingly, or recklessly, and they have to be proven by a preponderance of the evidence. So if NIH funding or PHS funding produced 100,000 papers a year, is it true that 2% of them have FFP? That's what the estimates would suggest. So that's what, 2,000 papers. So yes, it's ORI's job to help institutions adjudicate research misconduct that is intentional and knowing and reckless. But I think that there is so much more that we can do besides looking at those few numbers of scientists who are really intentionally almost sociopaths. One point that I want to bring to your attention is that in a misconduct case, there is the subject or the respondent and there is the complainant. So our data show that in most cases, the complainant has the rank of full professor, whereas in most cases, the respondent has a much more junior rank, that is research associate or technician, graduate student, postdoc, or assistant professor. So there seems to be a very strong gradient in those who are accused of performing research misconduct and those who are accusing them of doing that. And I think we have to look closely at what that clue tells us about the culture or environment that either promotes integrity or permits misconduct or even irreproducibility. For the last 5 years, the most instances of research misconduct that have been found have been in the category of data falsification. And in each year, between 50 and 80% of the findings have been image manipulations. And so that's improper cropping or contrast adjusting, reuse or relabeling. So to me, that is such a key point that goes back to accepted practices in the relevant communities. Institutions have to discern whether in their labs and in their responsible conduct of research training courses, there is sufficient detail about appropriate image manipulation. Because we all know you can't just publish raw data. You have to manipulate it appropriately to tell a story. But in that process, we're seeing a lot of misconduct happen. We also see many, many cases of inappropriate controls. So these are non-contemporaneous and inappropriate, not done at the same time, not done on the same animals, not done with the same protocols. I think that you would be shocked if you saw how many cases that we have done deep dives and have found that virtually every experiment that a researcher has done for 10 years has lacked appropriate controls. In doing these deep dives of data records, you know, when there is a misconduct case, sadly, the institution sequesters laboratory computers, notebooks, instrument computers, and a lot of records. And what we have seen is a very substandard level of record keeping. So these problems are compounded by collaborative science, where you have shared drives and shared folders and shared instrumentation without adequate controls to demonstrate who did what to the data set at what time. And this is a huge problem that we're seeing. It's compounded by problems of resources where schools are allowing graduate students to use their private laptop computers to do research because they don't really have the money to pay for laptops. And graduate students and postdocs for using places like Dropbox to share data and without the appropriate institutional oversight or controls. And so these issues are prevalent in all of the misconduct cases we have looked at. And some of them probably could be addressed by good data policies at institutional levels that talk about clouds and personal laptops. And I think that that has led in 2016 to a cry that was exemplified by Manya Baker's article in Nature in 2016 that was entitled How Quality Control Could Save Your Science. And so I do strongly believe, you know, I was a faculty member at Colorado State University for 20 years, and it was only at the end of my time there that the vice president for research brought in a QA manager and started to institutionalize quality assurance procedures. And I think that that is a key thing that institutions can do, particularly institutions that may not have as many resources, is to use the mechanisms of good laboratory practice, maybe, or GLP-like practices for quality improvement. These are very simple things about recording SOPs and validating them and auditing the use of protocols to collect data. And so I think that institutions that are not coupling their RCR instruction with their QA managers are missing an opportunity to teach labs how to do better record keeping. And I believe that better record keeping is going to reduce some of the irreproducibility issues. The main point that I have come to appreciate in my 10 months at ORI is the extent to which the institutional environment sets the tone that either leads to a culture of misconduct or a culture of promoting integrity. And so in cases where there has been one of these, say, sociopaths who has had 170 figures that are falsified or fabricated data, when you go back and listen to the 20 or 30 interviews of people at the institution, everybody knew it. Everybody knew what kind of lab environment it was. They knew about the pressure. They knew about the authorship disputes. They knew about abuses of the graduate students. They knew about abuses of the postdocs. The institution knew that there was a problem. And those problems are hard to address because a lot of times those researchers are the big rainmakers and cause a conflict in the institution as to how best to proceed. But I have come to believe that really the problem can't be solved by ORI. The problem has to be solved by institutions. And how we would like to partner with you is when you have good policies and procedures, data sharing, or authorship guidelines, if you can let us have those, we can disseminate them. And so I think that lots of institutions are doing lots of very good things, but other institutions don't necessarily know how to do that. And we would like to be a conduit for the dissemination of best practices, particularly around training graduate students and postdocs, because it's that magical apprenticeship relationship between a good student and her advisor that allows really innovative, groundbreaking research to occur. But it is also that special relationship which can be turned towards something very unhealthy and unproductive. And that stuff, I don't think the federal government can come in and be the marriage counselor for that kind of stuff. That has to happen at the institutional level by research scientists. There is an argument to be made that how ORI could help is by finding that poor mentoring or mismentoring or dismentoring, that's my favorite, dismentoring could be viewed as reckless conduct. Is it reckless misconduct? I think that's a very important question that ORI should tackle, that if we have so much evidence for mismanagement of training and pressure that causes students to manipulate images inappropriately, could we hold the PI responsible for that? And I hope that that's something that we'll be able to address in the upcoming months. Another area of grave concern that arises from this unique mentoring relationship is the trouble at institutions with handling whistleblowers. And so many public cases really have become litmus tests for how institutions deal with students who come forward. Trainees do a lot of the research. Frequently, trainees are the first ones to know there's something wrong, but trainees are the least powerful and most vulnerable. How do you proceed with your scientific career if you rat out your PI? It's virtually impossible to do. And that's another issue that we have to tackle together. I think that at some institutions, whistleblowers are protected by aggressive participation in their protection by the deans of the graduate schools. In other schools, that's not really happening. So we have to look at ways that students can bring to our attention issues in a lab without getting penalized. A student should not have to make a choice between doing the right thing and having no career, and doing the wrong thing and having a career. That's just not acceptable. The last thing I want to tell you about is kind of related to Lisa's comments on the Duke case, which is that ORI does have regulations regarding an institution's willingness to undertake research misconduct cases in the best of faith. That is, some people believe that some institutions are loath to do a very good investigation. I think all of you know that research misconduct investigations occur at the institution where the funding was received. ORI's role is just to do oversight review and make sure that they followed their processes and the law. And some people think that institutions have a conflict of interest in doing that. And I think that the regulations took that into account as a potential flaw in the process. And ORI has the ability, and it's one that we use about a dozen times a year, to do a compliance action on an institution after they have done a misconduct case. So an institution that fails to follow their process or fails to protect a whistleblower or in some other way doesn't fulfill their statutory obligation correctly, or I can come in afterwards and say, you guys need to take these steps in the future. And we do that. It's all kind of done in the background. Although we, I think, are legally permitted to publish those compliance actions, we haven't done it because I think that our spirit has been one of collaboration with institutions. It's in our mutual best interest to have science done with the highest integrity and greatest impact, and we want to work collaboratively with institutions when there's an allegation of misconduct that arises. So my take-home message is that I think that this kind of event is what's going to change the culture. And I'm so pleased there is an event somewhat like this at Stanford in December and at Columbia in December. And it's where these the brain power of groups like this can come up with output that can be shared with other institutions that we can figure out how to tackle some of these complex problems. And I want to tell you that we are totally committed to working with you on reproducibility issues that really are misconduct and the much larger percentage of reproducibility issues that reflect the nature of how science gets done and how it needs to be done in the future. So I think that's my comments.
I'm Jeff Botkin at the University here, Associate VP for Research, Research Integrity Officer. So a question for Dr. Partin. You mentioned briefly this question about reckless disregard. At the institutional level, we've had a great deal of difficulties struggling through what that means, because it's or reckless disregard. So we have had a couple of findings in which we thought the scientific process was so flawed that it constituted research misconduct. I wonder if you might speak a little bit more about how ORI has looked at the reckless disregard standard and whether the sorts of things that we have seen with some of these other studies might conceivably rise to a reckless disregard standard.
So the standard of proof is intentional, knowing, or reckless. And historically, most of ORI's findings have been intentional or knowing. I think that we're interested in bringing forward some cases that institutions have used that reckless standard and made a finding of misconduct and push harder on that. A lot of times, I'll just say, a lot of times when an institution uses a standard of reckless, when we go deep into the records, we see knowing and intentional. And so we're going to take it to knowing and intentional if we see that standard. But I do think that I'm very interested in this question of whether we could and should use that reckless standard more and what impact it would have. So I hope that you'll see in the next year maybe a couple of test cases where we try to do that and see what the outcome is.
Hi, I'm Paul Gabrielson. I'm a science writer here at the U. I'm a public information officer, which means my job is to communicate research results to the news media and to the public. So my role comes into this after the study has already been done, after the protocols have been designed, and the data has been crunched, but before there's a chance for post-publication review. Obviously, I want to promote good science, but as you mentioned, the flashier studies with better results make for an easier sell to media. So what do you feel like is my role in creating the culture of reproducibility at the institution?
That's a good one. I guess at very least you should be having fairly in-depth discussions with the leader of the research group that produced the research and make sure you understand what was actually done in the research and how the results should be appropriately interpreted. Because one of the other things that we find are that by the time spin is put on some of these results, they're actually not reporting very accurately what the findings were. And I realize that's a challenge if you're not actually the scientist yourself. But this is where I think having some good discussions with the people who do know what went on. And I wonder, frankly, if it wouldn't be helpful even for institutional media representatives to get some opinions from people outside of the research group, much as there are invited commentaries for journal articles. Maybe you should pay attention to those. Maybe you should actually go out and try and get some comments from other individuals who are not vested in the result.
I'm Russ Teichert. I'm in the Department of Biology. I'm research faculty. So I have a comment. It seems to me that if we're not getting the results that we want and expect, we're probably incentivizing the wrong things. And one of the incentives that seems quite wrong to me is that only kind of high-profile science that seems to be groundbreaking gets rewarded. So if you're a postdoc and you want a tenure-track faculty position, you have to have first author papers in Nature and Science. I mean, every job talk I go to, the job candidate is introduced and the person announces which first author papers they have in Nature and Science, every single one. You won't get interviews if you don't have them. And so it's not enough to just do good quality research. You have to be doing, you know, something that has a wow factor to it. And that seems like that kind of incentive leads to the kind of problems we're seeing in research irreproducibility. So would you please comment on that?
Yeah, well, I certainly agree with you. I think that NIH recognizes that problem, and there's been discussion of revamping the reward system and the evaluation, but it's going to take a big culture change. And it's going to have to, I know there have been discussions about reformatting biosketches that are submitted with NIH grants so that maybe you could focus on, and I don't know where those efforts are, but there have been discussion of focusing on not just, you know, bean counting publications and particularly bean counting publications in the quote big journals, but trying to come at it more from the point of view of what was the investigator's real contribution, what was the impact of those findings. I mean, even if you look at some of the big, you know, Nobel Prize winning work, it wasn't all published in Nature or Cell or Science. You know, it's often the people who do the really good methodical work that may not look flashy in the early stages, but eventually it will have a big impact. And so the tough thing is that process takes a long time, and to expect someone who's very junior in their career to have already built that kind of evidence of the value of the research they're doing is very difficult. So I guess that's the best answer I can give you, that people are aware of the problem, and it's going to take a lot of cooperation amongst stakeholders, and there are going to have to be some universities who are daring enough to change their way of evaluating their own faculty.
So there's an interesting, very provocative paper that was published this September in one of the Royal Society journals that I believe it's on your resource website for this meeting. I'm sorry, I didn't write the thing down, but it's basically a model of how bad science drives good scientists out of the business, essentially the points that you're making. But it's a formal model, very interesting article in September. Maybe Melissa, we could. Yeah, sorry, I forgot to write it down. But
I mean, I think we could just start right back at the universities. What can your P&T committees do to demonstrate the value of rigorous studies? They might not be the most innovative, but they are the most important in either reproducing important findings or not reproducing them. Because I think that's really the question, is how do P&T committees allow junior faculty to do experiments that might not have a positive result?
I'm Scott, I'm a physician. I was interested in your comments about the seniority issue, because my own observation is on every paper where I'm a first author, I have a senior author who knows almost nothing about what I've done. And on many papers in which I'm sandwiched in between numerous co-authors, I know nothing about what has been done. I was engaged in the conception of the idea during some informal office meeting or something like that. But I wonder if it's the senior guys who are pursuing the junior guys, as you suggested. Are the junior guys being the fall guys for the senior author who should have taken responsibility, right? Because on every first junior author, isn't there a mentor who's the last author who should be getting as much grief as the junior guy? Do you have any comments about how these seniority relationships are playing out in this?
Yeah, I think there are some studies that support what you're saying. Obviously, there's two arguments. One is that the senior people are better trained and less likely to trip into misconduct. And the other, that it really shows the dark underbelly of science, that accusations are made against junior people who don't have tenure and against foreign-born scientists who don't have the same protection. And so I think that without stating that it's always one or always the other, we have to accept that both things are probably at play, and we have to figure out as institutions what we're going to do about that.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Robert Welsh. I'm a physicist in the psychiatry department. This is more of a question for you, Dr. McShane. So the p-value of 0.05, that's a random thing that Fisher came up with half a century ago. Is it something that we need to re-examine? That physics went through that, particle physics especially went through that re-examination, and for their discovery, it's a five sigma effect, where in biological sciences, it's a two sigma effect. And how should we address that core question? And then with respect to that, that's then going to impact, because that'll, effect sizes and power, that then impacts how big grants need to be, because the $500,000 limit on R01s has been set for a while, and it's getting a bit tight.
Okay, there were a lot of issues wrapped up in that question. But, I mean, I certainly would agree with you that the p-value in the magic 0.05 has been totally abused. I think it probably grew out of a need to have some type of assessment of the evidence, because we still see a lot of papers where people did a zillion tests, their sample sizes were way too small to be convincing about anything, and so a p-value was one way that people tried to get at that and say, well, can you at least show me that it's not likely to be a statistical fluke? But the p-value fails, really stops having any meaning when you're doing a lot of data dredging. And so I guess I would say that we need to educate people on how to develop a convincing body of evidence. And statistical analysis of the data is only one really small part of that. And it shouldn't be the magic boundary that you have to cross. I would much rather see a really well-executed study that had a p-value of 0.06, then I would like to see a tiny little poorly designed study that had a p-value of 0.0001. So I think it's really going to have to, we're going to have to rely on journal editors, and we're going to have to educate investigators so that they understand it's not just about a p-value. But unfortunately, there are journals who have historically taken a very hard line, and if you don't cross that 0.05 line, you're not in. And I think that's bad. And there's been some, it was mentioned, Hilda mentioned about the ASA came out with a statement kind of saying, let's be more reasonable about how we use this p-value, and it's not all about a p-value. And there's at least one journal, I think it's in psychology, that has forbidden the use of p-values. And I'm not sure that's the right answer either. But we need to have more interpretable assessments about the strength of the evidence. And however that happens is probably going to be individualized to the particular situation. But it all needs to go back to, was it a well-designed study in the first place? Because I don't care what p-value you give me if it was a crappy study to begin with. And I think that's what we have to emphasize more to people. And I think the journals are really moving in that direction, at least the three that I mentioned. They are doing a more rigorous statistical review. They're actually hiring statisticians to go through very carefully and say, is there bias or confounding? Was the sample size adequate? And do the conclusions presented, are they supported by the data analyses and the results? So that's, it's a very complicated kind of picture. And I think any attempt to simplify it into a boundary for a p-value is just the totally wrong way to go.
So I'd like to go back to something that was brought up, I think, twice now, and do it from the perspective of what are the biggest problems that are going to be the hardest to solve? And I would argue that the biggest problem is that if you're a postdoc, you're a junior faculty member, you will not succeed today unless you have a breakthrough. And often, you're working under a senior person who realizes that and focuses on breakthroughs, and I'm more skeptical about how bad people are than than others. I think that there's a lot of really bad people in this business, and that they have developed an approach which is how to make it so that the junior person is going to take the fall for something that they're going to help put together as just deliberately bad science. And so they have a plan that is going to be that every piece of work has to be a breakthrough, and that junior person knows that if they don't have a breakthrough, they don't have a career, and that pressure is so huge, and I don't see a way to solve it. I mean, I have young people that work in my group, for example, that see people doing profoundly bad science, getting into great journals, and getting K99s, and getting jobs, and it's all because they're on the verge of curing a disease. And when you look at those papers in journal clubs, there's just all sorts of flaws. And I don't see any way to really get around that other than you know, some of us old folks just going on the attack. I don't see any other way to get around that. And I'd invite anybody to give me some sense of how we can solve that problem.
Before you answer, I'm really following up with what Ed said. So basically, if you look at the solicitations from NSF or NIH in terms of grants, they have to be transformative. They've got to be innovative. They've got to be new. And if you were going to propose Specific Aim 1 to replicate a study that you're basing your laboratory research on, the likelihood, I would think, being on a lot of advisory committees and that would be very unlikely that you would get funded. And it gets back to what Ed was saying in terms of having to make a breakthrough on your grants, having to make a breakthrough. And NIH, you put up that about rigor and that, and I thought that was great. But if they've thought about in terms of advice to study sections that you're looking at, you know, that maybe some of this has to be a replication to move forward, but what's the likelihood that you would ever get funded if that's what you were proposing to do? And I think that follows up with you. You've got to do something new and exciting to be able to get your grants, to be able to get your publications, to be able to get your jobs. And it is a cultural kind of thing that I think scientists could do.
If you're gonna try and claim anything, I mean, I've dealt with this for 5 or 10 years, to replicate anything, I mean, that's going nowhere so fast. And the only way, I mean, I just got a grant that I don't think a young person could get. It was me and another person who were just gray-haired, grumpy old guys. And basically, we just called out a whole line of work, and that got funded, but that could only be funded because I'm just a grumpy old guy. It could never be funded by a young person. They'd get killed. That's the core problem. That's the core problem. The young people have no chance for a career unless they're in one of these labs that are making these breakthroughs. And those folks, a lot of them, have figured out how to make that junior person take the fall if it isn't good science. I think that's our number one big problem.
Then aren't you encouraged by, I'll say I'm encouraged by post-publication review and the idea of feeding that back into PubMed somehow, I think is amazingly transformative as far as changing the incentive to be from grant to grant to your reputation as a scientist. And so maybe it's not the panacea, but I have a lot of faith in post-publication review in its infancy, which I think it is right now, as one tool to cleaning up that incentive problem.
Well, Aliva, I do have 4 cells in my body that are not grumpy, but but I agree with you. But I guess what I'd say is, can you see that young postdoc writing that post-publication comment to the prominent star in the field at Harvard and saying, oh, you know, you didn't do any controls. They're not going to do it. The only people that can really get away with that and survive and not survive easily are grumpy old guys. That's that's what I would argue. I mean, I think you're right. I mean, we have to go forward. I don't want to... You know, like I said, I have 4 cells that aren't grumpy.
Well, I'm an old guy too. I'm not really grumpy, Ed. But there's some. But your point, I think it's a good point. But the two fields that have shown the most concern about replicability, I would think, is psychology and preclinical biology. And in psychology, there have been a number of calls for part of each dissertation to be a replication, to include a replication of one of the key studies leading to that. I mean, I think there would be some practical issues to do that in biology, but it is an approach that's out there as a suggestion for how to correct some of the problems in these fields, at least as a positive step.
Okay, I'm Nelson Beebe from the Department of Mathematics. One of the things I do is read a lot in a lot of different areas of science and engineering. And occasionally I come across a book that I think is one that everybody in a given field should read, and I'd like to recommend one now that has to do with statistical analysis. It's a book by McCloskey and Ziliak, and it's called The Cult of Statistical Significance. The authors are at the University of Chicago. They're eminent researchers in their own right, and it's a fairly large book, and it looks at a number of studies that have been published in both medicine and in finance and economics, and call into question the statistics applied in those papers. And largely it reduces to improper application of statistical methods, and secondly, application of statistics to samples that are far too small to have any statistical significance whatever. And I really think everybody in this room who's worried about research in the social sciences and the medical sciences and the reproducibility of research needs to go out and get that book and read it and understand the statistics better and realize that they really do need the help of good statisticians. Thank you.
Hope somebody will tweet that so we can all retweet that reference.
I'm Carol Sweeney, and I'm a faculty from the medical school, and my comment is going to be about statistics, but I'll just mention that I'm actually an epidemiologist, not a statistician, but I really enjoyed some of the examples that Dr. McShane brought up about inappropriate use of statistical tests and having someone do the analysis who isn't really well trained in statistics. So I've been involved in our Center for Clinical Translational Science here from the research education perspective, and also in my past experience as a faculty member. And so I just wanted to comment on the challenge of, you know, I see there are two of them. One is training non-statisticians to know some statistics. So students who are getting a Ph.D. or physicians who are going to be doing research, and who's going to teach statistics to them. It's actually quite challenging because statisticians, to succeed in their own career world, you know, the rewards to them are if they do theoretical work. And if they teach, if they mentor other statisticians who are in the future going to do theoretical work. So getting statisticians who are willing and who are able to communicate with the non-math world is a big challenge. I think we've done a lot to address it at this institution, but I just thought I'd mention it since Dr. McShane is obviously communicating really well with us as a statistician. And then the other part is just trying to recruit statisticians who are willing to make their career in a collaborative role with biomedical science, as opposed, because I mean, we have positions open here, and you know, people are being interviewed, and finding someone who has both the communication skills and the willingness for that role. So I just thought I would comment on it, since you've emphasized how important it is.
Yeah, no, those are excellent comments, and I totally agree with you. You know, there are problems in the reward structure for statisticians as well, and there's actually a shortage of statisticians. You know, we hear stories like, you know, at the major American Statistical Association meeting, there might be 10 openings for every one person who puts their name in as an applicant. And once you narrow that down to the people who, as you said, can bridge that gap and communicate with the non-statisticians, you're getting down to really small numbers of people who are capable. And one of the things we've found to be a big problem is that many statisticians in biomedical research institutions, they cobble together their salary by getting like 10% on each of 10 different grants. And that just doesn't allow you the time to have the kind of good communications and integration into the study team. And it presents a lot of problems. And the other thing that's very difficult is that, sure, if the grant is approved, then the statistician gets their funding, their 10% or whatever it is. But some of the most important input that is needed from the statistician is the design of the study and writing that statistical section for the grant. And they get nothing for that. OK, okay? Because if the grant doesn't make it, too bad, okay? And they are just so much at the mercy of what happens with the whole research project. And I think that was a problem actually noted in the Duke example. There was a very junior statistician who had, you know, in his case, it was actually a fair chunk of his funding from that lab. And if that those projects went down the tubes, so is his funding. I mean, that's you know, you're really in a precarious position. So I think the institutions need to have proper support systems for statisticians. And I think that having centralized statistical groups where you might have people specialize and interact particularly with certain biomedical specialty groups is really a better model than having a statistician owned, you know, in 10 different places, 10 different pieces of them spread throughout all those places.
I'll just make one further comment, which just sort of anecdotally what I hear is it varies so much across the NIH study sections, the extent to which the statistics are actually scrutinized. Because, yeah. Again, epidemiology sections, they, oh my goodness, really scrutiny. And then also, though, do they actually have a statistician named and funded on the grant who actually knows something about the field as opposed to, you know, help them develop it, but isn't even going to be paid. And not all study sections are going to pay attention to that.
Right. Now, I think we're hoping to move in that direction. If you notice that in the new guidelines for the grants, it talks about rigor and actually mentions things like having sample size calculations and study design details. So I think that's been recognized. But it's going to take a while till it's really fully adopted and operating well in every single grant study section. And I've certainly observed what you say you have observed, that there has been huge variability. You know, I see get to see the summary reviews of a number of grants, and some of them the statistician was really reviewer in the study section was really engaged, you know, really got into what the research was all about and made sure the proper statistics were there. And in other cases, you get cursory comments. Although I had an interesting experience one time, I sometimes get called to sit on various review bodies. Now I don't review for NIH study section because the obvious, you know, sort of issue that would raise. I do sometimes review things after the fact if they recognize there might have been statistical issues that were raised by the study section, but they need someone to kind of bring them to completion and figure out whether it's a go or a no-go. I might get involved at that point. But I was once called by another government agency, which will remain nameless, asking me if I would sit on a study section and review, I think it was like 2 or 3 dozen grants they had. And they basically said, you'll get the grants about 2 weeks in advance, and you know, we have the statistician look at all of them. And I asked the person who called me, I said, well, how many grants do the non-statisticians in the study section look at? I said, well, you know, they'll specialize, so maybe they'll look at 2 or 3 of the grants. And I said, in order to do a good statistical review of a grant, you need to understand the research that's being done in the grant so that you can understand what are the study design issues, what are the appropriate analysis strategies. So needless to say, I turned down that opportunity to have 2 weeks to review 2 or 3 dozen grants. And I think that's sort of an ignorance on the part of some study section coordinators, to be quite honest, that if you really want a good statistical review and if you want good statistics to happen in the study, you have to have the statisticians integrated into the review teams and integrated into the study teams. And I also had an interesting experience, maybe I shouldn't air dirty laundry, but I was invited to a meeting sort of as a last minute thing of some, let's say, leaders in the field. And they were talking about the problem of reproducibility. And I sat there for about an hour, hour and a half, and almost every one of the issues brought up was statistical. And I said, when I finally got my chance to talk, I said, I'd like to make one observation. I said, just about every issue you've discussed is statistical. And as far as I'm aware, I'm the only card-carrying statistician sitting in this room, and I was invited a day before as an afterthought. Okay, so even leadership, even you know, leaders in the field need to understand the role of statisticians.
Melissa, this gentleman's been waiting. Can we take his question?
Hi, my name is Nicholas Lee. I'm an undergraduate student. I'm hoping to get into research, and I'm really scared that, you know, giving my ideas will prevent me from getting into the field. I agree with the old grumpy gentleman over here. My question, my observation is that the discussion today has been mainly that we need a culture change, and my question is who is going to lead that change, and what is the responsibility of the undergraduate students? What can we do? It seems to me that we need to reproduce the research, and the undergraduate students need to learn the research. Why not have the undergraduates reproduce other people's studies and see whether it works or not? I mean, the old guys might not like the young guys saying they did something wrong, but they could definitely learn from it. What are your thoughts?
Well, for sure, if you're an undergraduate doing research, you need good mentors. You need 5 mentors. You need mentors from inside the system and outside the system. You need to make sure that those are people who have high ethical standards. You need to be at an institution like this one where from the president down to the provost or the vice president for research, people are talking about doing innovative research with integrity. And so I do think that you're the hope of all of us. The next generation of scientists are the ones going to be solving the problems that need to be solved. And so don't be discouraged. You need to do this, but you need good mentors who have high ethical standards to help navigate what your project should be and how risky it should be and when you need to be focusing on getting your training and when you need to be focusing on cleaning up the literature. I, for one, think the old grumpy guy should clean up the literature.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have a lot to add to what Kathy said, but there have been discussions about having separate sort of pots of money set aside specifically for validation studies, and I think that's what it's probably going to take, because as you said, if you submit a grant that's talking about validating other people's work, you will get not innovative nerfed. Okay, so it really puts people in a tough position, and without some kind of special effort to get those validation studies done, I think it's really going to be tough. And one of the things that makes it difficult is we know the funding is so tight. And so it's difficult to, as a funding organization, to make a choice between, well, should we fund this many more investigators doing innovative work, or should we take away some of that money, which is already too small an amount, to give it to people to try and reproduce somebody else's work. So it's just, that's why it's so difficult. I mean, it's just not an easy problem to tackle.
The first step in addressing any really serious problem is to become aware of it and understand the scope and seriousness of the problem. And then in a university, all of us believe, and we think many of you probably believe, that replicability is a serious problem. In a university research setting, we rely on the faculty to be the leaders in addressing research-related problems. So I think our hope for this conference is that faculty and students and other people involved in research will realize that they're going to have to, the researchers will have to be the ones that implement the solutions with encouragement and incentives from the journals and the funding agencies. But until the researchers recognize the problem and decide to address it, we won't make progress. Maybe we'll end there. I want to thank our panelists for their time and great insights. Let's
I'd like to echo my thanks. Thank you to Dr. Parks, Dr. Partin, and Dr. McShane for that wonderful conversation. I think we all learned a lot and came up with a lot of different ideas on how we can move forward and address some of the challenges.